afternoon. I'm Nelson Weiss, president of the City Club. I want to welcome you all to our special midweek forum. Special because it's a second forum for this week, but very, very special because of our guest today. We have as our guest Colonel Robert F. Overmyer, United States Marine Corps, NASA astronaut, and of course, the pilot of the Space Shuttle Columbia on its most recent successful flight. Colonel Overmyer is a native of Westlake, Ohio, so it's homecoming for him as well. He graduated from Westlake High School in 1954. He received a Bachelor of Science degree in physics from Baldwin-Wallace in 1958. A Master of Science degree in Aeronautics with a major in Aeronautical Engineering from the United States Naval Postgraduate School in 1964. Colonel Overmyer was selected as a NASA astronaut in 1969. His first assignment with NASA was engineering development duties on the Skylab program. From November of 71 until December of 1972, he was a support crew member for Apollo 17, and was the launch capsule communicator. January of 1973 until July of 1975, he was a support crew member for the Apollo-Soyuz test project and was the NASA capsule communicator in the Mission Control Center in Moscow. In 1976, he was assigned duties on the Space Shuttle Approach and Landing Test Program and was the prime chase pilot for the Orbiter Free Flights 1 and 3. And, of course, as we know, the pilot on the most recent Columbia space shuttle. Colonel Overmyer is married and has three children. It's a pleasure to have with us as well Mrs. Overmyer, who's sitting at the front table here. It's a pleasure to have you with us. It's also a pleasure to have Mayor and Mrs. Bush from Westlake, who are here with us also at the front table. Colonel Overmyer will speak to us in the regular manner, and we will have our questions and answers afterwards. Colonel, it's a pleasure to have you with us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It is indeed an honor and a pleasure to be here today. I had a tremendous homecoming in Westlake. Open-air convertible in a cold December day evening. Enjoyed that tremendously. Went by my home out on Canterbury Road, where I lived for a good number of years, right from the time I moved to Westlake. A very moving experience, tremendously moving experience. I'm really thrilled to be here. I'm thrilled to be here in Cleveland. Cleveland, even though I called Westlake my hometown, let's face it, we were greater Clevelanders than we still are. We relied a great deal on Cleveland for a tremendous amount of support. Even then, I'm sure Westlake does at this time still. I spent one of my summers working right down on the Cuyahoga River, if you will, in the Republic Steel Mills. In fact, I just mentioned that a couple of days ago, that I knew what the inside of a blast furnace looked like, and when we were coming down to that shuttle approach, and everything started glowing red out there, and the windows turned red. I said, I'd just like us back inside the blast furnace. I knew what it was darn near as hot, too. I'm tremendously proud to be here today, and I feel a great honor to represent NASA and to have represented Cleveland and Ohio on the space shuttle. STS-5, for me, began in the late fall of 1981. I had numerous engineering development duties, as Nelson had told you. But in the late fall of 1981, I was pulled together with three other fantastic guys and told that we were going to fly the first four-man crew of the shuttle, assuming that the first four test flights went well, and Vance and I were going to be combined with Bill Lenore and Joe Allen, our two mission specialists, and we would form the first four-man crew ever of a United States spacecraft, and I believe the first four-man crew ever in a single spacecraft. And we had a very basic job to do. We were to launch safely, get into orbit, and deploy two commercial satellites, and to return and land safely. If we did that, we had accomplished 100% of our mission. We were the proof of concept of the shuttle. The shuttle was born in concept in 1971 when some very far-thinking people in NASA administration at the time realized that there was an exploding demand for satellites on orbit and for a lifetime on orbit, and that we would be able to do many fantastic things if we could just figure out how to get man up there cheaper and more efficiently. And thus, the shuttle was born. From 1971 through many design studies of 72, 73, and 74, and some very serious scrubs and concerns, and would the technology support what we were trying to do, we never compromised on one basic mission of the shuttle: to get man up safely to space, to take a relatively large payload and deliver it to space, and get man safely back from space, and for the most part, to be reusable so we can turn around and do it again with minimum expense. So for me to be on that first ride was indeed a thrill that we were going to take our communication satellites, the first operational mission of the space shuttle. We never compromised on our major requirement to be able to get the payloads to orbit. Many a time we looked at our launch profile and said, we just got to soften it up. We've got to make it a softer ride for our satellites. We can't afford to bang them around and bounce them around as other delivery systems do. We also realized that we had to be able to bring back payloads in case they malfunctioned, and we should, before we deployed them, we had to be able to bring them back. And for a good number of years, even though I had other duties as assigned, we constantly came back to the shuttle because I knew shuttle was the mode that I was going to get to space. And lo and behold, it came. And along with your faith in the shuttle, we had the faith of a couple of customers. The Satellite Business Systems Corporation in Washington, D.C., a conglomerate made up put together a marriage between the Aetna Insurance Company, IGAM, and the ComSat Corporation, realized the tremendous potential to the business community of cheap and easy access for data transmission, mainly data, television, and telephone transmission. One of their biggest customers is General Motors Company, with their stations here, even in Cleveland, I believe, can talk to the satellite, SBS satellites overhead, and talk directly with data transmission to their plants in Los Angeles. I know the SBS system itself uses it, the IBM people use it, to talk throughout their plants throughout the country. Again, tremendous explosion in the data transmission. SBS was one of the first people to sign up and said, hey, we can get to space and access to space cheaper if we do it on the shuttle, and they signed on the dotted line, and I'm tremendously proud of them for that. The Telesat people were not far behind. Telesat is a corporation that is partly public, partly private in Canada, and they lease their services to the telephone companies of satellite. And yes, even the name of their satellite, the Anik spacecraft, as it was called, these are all Hughes 376 spacecraft communication satellites, but they named theirs Anik. Anik is an Eskimo word for brother. And the whole intent of that satellite is to tie in the far out reaches of the Canadian land, the far northern reaches up on the tundra, to tie those communities in to the central telephone system of Canada, give access so that those people are no longer living in the outreach beyond communication. They don't have to rely on radio waves that bounce off the atmosphere and do strange things. In fact, go directly to a satellite, and they can pick up their telephones now using the Telesat satellites, do a direct dial, and dial right from some of those far northern towns, the names escape me right now, but can dial directly from them right into Ottawa if they have to. So with two very vision-seeing customers, we were off on Shuttle 5. The year of training, coupled on top of the 12 years of basic training and work I had done at NASA, was extremely intense, tremendously enjoyable, My wife suffered the most. My family suffered by my not being there, and I'm tremendously proud of the way they handled it. I think the pressure at times was harder on them than it was on us. Many, many long hours, tremendous dedication because we knew, and dedication by our mission specialists, because we knew that the successful deployment of these satellites had to be demonstrated to sign on more and more people to use the space shuttle. The time rapidly went by until we were actually going into quarantine 7 days prior to the launch, medical quarantine, but really it is a medical quarantine, but it's more than that. It's a matter of way of getting us isolated from all the people that have thought of that last-minute thing that might go wrong, and they feel they have to warn you about it so they can bear your time, bear their soul and bear their conscience on you so they can be conscience-free, but you're stuck with it. So I heard in that last week before we went into quarantine, I heard of every possible conceivable way those boosters could blow up. Right about that time, I really didn't need that. But, yes, those are the good engineers of NASA and our contractors, and really their heart's in the right place. And we felt totally prepared. The week of quarantine went by extremely fast. It seemed like just a blink of the eye after all these years that we were walking out that morning, November 11th, out of the ONC building, the operations building at the Cape, going out to the van. After all these years, it was kind of like a Walter Mitty feeling. What am I doing here? I finally have seen so many of my friends and contemporaries go, this is my turn, and it was a tremendous thrill all the way. And I'm still grinning, and I haven't stopped grinning since that time. It was pitch black when we went out, and we had no idea what the weather was going to be like, although we'd been briefed that it was going to be clear at the Cape. The Cape weather was important to us because we have an abort capability to return land to the Cape within the first 4 minutes. Something should go wrong within the first 4 minutes of launch. 4 minutes, 12 seconds for the technicians in the room. After that is what they call negative return. That's the call, negative return. We got in the spacecraft and strapped in. We started doing our duties as required. And we had some built-in launch holds, which are a nice way of saying it's a chance for the hold the ground and everybody to get caught up and take a breath and figure out where they're going from here. At each of those holds, I had a chance to sit back and reflect on what I was doing. I noticed that one of the seagulls had done a job on my window, and I was going to have a dirty window for the rest of the mission, unfortunately. But as the sun came up, off to the east, my window on the right side of the spacecraft points right to the east, and it sits on the planet. As the sun came up, I could see just little bitty clouds out over, way out of the Atlantic, and absolutely a gorgeous, no clouds in the sky at the Cape. And having been through enough launches here, I knew that this was going to be a spectacular time. And I was almost envious of the show that the people on the ground were going to get, although I knew I was in for a pretty good show, too. And we come on down to T0, and his mains cut in. You can feel the throbbing of the vehicle as it kind of strained against the hold down for a second or two, and then those solids cut in. And that is the biggest kick in the butt you'll ever get in your life. I'll tell you, we had 7 million pounds of thrust. We weighed about 4 million pounds on the pad, so we had 3 million pounds excess. And that just took us up that launch. It just went by so fast, you wouldn't believe it. First stage for me was very exciting, because we had in our computers a pre-programmed load of winds, the mean November winds, the average November winds were loaded in, and we expected a wind from the west. We woke up that morning and found out the winds were from the east at altitude. They had run that in the simulator and determined that it was acceptable within limits. So we launched into those easterly winds instead of the westerly winds. It had two effects on us. It depressed our trajectory a little bit. We didn't get quite as high as we had planned at the very beginning. But more importantly, it gave a tremendous amount of wind shear, which was gotten in the boat. So we went banging up on that first stage. It felt pretty much like if you took your car and drove it down the railroad ties for about about 20 miles. We went banging around some fish, and we actually stressed the orbiter to 100% of design load according to strain gauges on board. So we had all the load we could handle. And a couple times there, I thought maybe we had more load than we could handle. It was pretty exciting. And got to 27 miles up, then I took a sneaky peek out the window, and I noticed you could almost start seeing the black of space in the horizon, and had to get back to work on the engines, monitoring. When the solids dropped away, it was a big flash. The flame engulfed the orbiter as the solids broke away, and it parachuted successfully into the ocean and have been retreating over the place of time. Second stage was just as smooth as last. I can't think of anything smoother than saying it's like riding an absolutely smooth electric car. It was just really whirring in the background, and there wasn't a glitch, there wasn't a bobble, and the steering needle centered up for us finally after the first stage. They were off scale, and we didn't know where we were going for sure. And they centered up for us, and our guidance converged as the terminology we used, and we knew we were going, and we looked like we were going to orbit. We passed the 8,300 feet per second. Velocity about 8,000 miles per hour, and got our negative return. That means at that point we were committed to either once around orbit, or if something went bad at that point, we could land in Dakar. Now, Dakar is not a particular in the Senegal. They don't have a long enough runway for me as far as I'm concerned, and they got a steep cliff on either end. So all I wanted to do was just keep going. We didn't want to lose an engine. And lo and behold, we kept going right up to the engine cutoff. The G's built up as expected, the throttles throttled down as expected, and there was a little bit of a clank, and we were just short of orbit. We were just coasting the engine that cut off. And time went by exceedingly fast. And the simulator, if you ever flew it, it's from launch to the first home burn, the orbital maneuver system burn that started us into our actual supervisor orbit, is about 12 minutes. And in the simulator, time again, we had these practice panics where you had 14 failures all the way up, and the airplane was just barely hanging in there by the time you got to orbit. And if you ever then practiced a nominal run where there were no failures, it seemed like those longest 12 minutes in the world. In the real world, that's the shortest 12 minutes I had over there, because it seemed to me I blinked my eye and the tower went by, and the next thing I know, we were coasting in orbit. And it just went by that fast. I vaguely recall doing all the things I was supposed to do. Kind of automatically, the train came through, but it was certainly a different experience. The time really stood still. Because we had elected to deploy the SBS on the first day, we had a very busy schedule. We had to get the spacecraft ready to stay in orbit, and then we had to prep it and deploy the satellite. We had a few hours in the middle of the day when things got kind of jovial. We had a good time, we had a good lunch, and just kind of enjoyable time. But I could feel the tension mount, the tension in me, and Vance, my command, our commander, and two mission specialists, because we knew the moment of truth was very soon coming. And late that afternoon, our time, I'm not sure what it was, Cleveland time or Houston time, but about 6 hours into the flight after liftoff, about 1 o'clock your time, we entered the sequence where we activated the satellites, spun up, back in the payload bay, and came down, counted down to T0 just as we crossed the equator. Somebody promised me there'd be a line down there, I could see when we're crossing the equator, and that's a line. It was just blue water, I guarantee it. All the maps have a red line or a black line there, but just blue water. And we punched off that first satellite. And the one thing that happened on that satellite that we weren't prepared for, of all our training, there was a loud bang. We had expected no noise at all. And there was a bang of the pyros separating that satellite. And in retrospect, both Bill and Joe and I, and Vance also, we sort of realized that. But there was a heck of a bang, and we just thought something had broken back there. And Bill snaps around. He was up, and I was up in the front seat. My job was flying the orbiter at the time. And Bill snaps around, and the guy that broke it looks out the back, and he's going up, doing it just so nicely. And literally that day, it was euphoric on board. We just felt tremendous, just felt tremendous. And we got up the morning the second day and had a great deal of work to do to recirculate a little bit, get it ready for the Telesat deploy. We had to do an escape burn away from the satellite the day before, so we had to recirculate our orbit to 160 and circle it. That was occupied Vance and I a great deal that day morning. And we went in tell us that to be quiet. Of course, we're still nervous. We've done it once, and we want it to be, as Joe said, two for two. Lo and behold, we spun up Telesat and kicked it out of the bay, and by golly, we were two for two, and we coined the phrase, we deliver. And that phrase kind of stuck with us. And we've often said it isn't we deliver, it's NASA delivers, the American taxpayer delivers. And you as representatives here should be very, very proud of what we accomplished and what NASA has. We told the world in 1971 we were going to go do it. It took a few more years, and we thought that by golly, we might do it. And I think that speaks highly of all the support that we got from the Lewis Research Center, tremendous support, as we got support from all our centers, the communities in Cleveland, the contractors here, the tremendous people in this TRW that have been working on shuttle. There's just tremendous. The number's too big to mention the number of Ohio companies that are on shuttle. Orbit. Yeah, three. Everybody's asked me in the past, what do I think about? What's my main feeling about space? And I have basically four areas that I cannot marry them together. I am unable to talk about them as a lump, but they're four distinct things that just fascinated me. And one is the fact that every 90 minutes, you go through one sunset and one sunrise. And the sunsets and sunrise, I guarantee you, try to capture it on film. In fact, Joe shot on so much film, I kept getting concerned we're going to shoot up all our film, just taking sunrise and sunset. You cannot capture on film the stark beauty of those sunrises and sunsets because you have the absolute deep black of space, pitch black, absolute pitch black. And then you'll have the lesser gray, deep black, this is the night side, as you come into the sunrise, that you can just barely make out as the Earth's horizon. All of a sudden, the sun will start peeking out, and you'll get these beautiful lines of red and blue expanding, depending on how the sun's coming up. And they expand, and we must have shot 40 slides of that alone. And then, just about time when the beauty is just indescribable, the sun goes bang, and it's up above the horizon, and you are in sunlight, and it's just that sharp. It's just in one instant. To look at the sun, it's like just looking at black, and the next instant to try and stare at one of those lights up there. You just can't do it. The sun is so bright. And as long as I live, I'll never forget 89 sunrises and 89 sunsets. It's just absolutely unbelievable. The other part of orbit, then, after the sunrise, when we can look out on the world, certain attitudes we had, you can look. And I think we could see about 6,000 miles in any direction off to the horizon. Saw the beautiful event, and those looking out on the oblique way out angles, you saw the blue of the ocean, tremendous blue, and the white of the clouds all around it formed, as we've all seen these pictures in space, just a jewel, literally a jewel. And I only had a chance to reflect on that a number of times, and I couldn't help but reflect that it's too beautiful to have been done by accident, that something had to create that. And then the other one that I was unable to split out was we had a number of passes every day where we could look straight down at the world. And it turned out that every morning for breakfast was about, for our breakfast on board, was about high noon in Australia. And so every morning we made two passes by Australia while we were getting our breakfast meal ready and getting ready to do day work. And we get glide by and look over the whole coast, the whole country of Australia, the whole planet there. In total, sitting there eating my burnt scrambled eggs one day, and I burned them, so I don't have any blame for that. But eating my scrambled eggs and just a tourist view of Australia. And I marveled at the fact that down on the continent of Australia, you have Aborigines still living literally in the Stone Age. And here we went gliding by in one of the world's most fantastic complex machines you've ever seen. And then for lunch, we did work in between. I can vouch for that. But lunch would come, and we would catch lunch behind him over the coast over Africa, all of Africa. We did see Africa other times during daytime, but usually your job did not allow you to reflect the
to look down at Africa. We would pass over Dakar. And there is a picture that we took that ought to become a classic, if it isn't already a classic, of Lake Chad. The Sahara Desert is marching south at the rate of about 40 miles a year. There's a tremendous amount of starvation because of that, because the people cannot move. These entities called countries and that have drawn their lines, and the people who are being pushed out can no longer go south, so they are literally starving. Lake Chad, 1961, some of the first photos of it, was about 300,000 square mile lake. When we went over it, you can see the dry area that the lake had been. It's reduced down to about a 500 square mile lake right now. And I think in about the next 5 years, they predict it will dry up and be a dry lake. So if you're not a believer that we have a change in the world, all you have to do is look at that picture. You can see what in the last 20 years has been wrought on one simple lake in Africa. To look at all the tributaries and the various rivers in Africa and to go over the black jungle was itself fascinating. Again, I couldn't help but marvel at the tremendous advancements we had made to be flying. And then every evening, again for supper, we just happened to catch South America at its high noon. And so a typical evening pass just prior to going to bed, we would come by Hawaii, and it was very clear and beautiful to us all the way from starting the westernmost island, Niihau, and all the way through to all the Kauai, Molokai, Kahalani, the target island of Maui, and the big island with the Mauna Kea, Mauloa. Just were spectacular. I could see the runways at Hollywood International from space. I could literally see them on the planet. And that's one of our board fields. It's interesting to see. We would then come sweeping along in orbit. We'd kind of come up north, and we would then pass right down the Baja. We missed the Panama Canal. It was cloud covered every time. We wanted to get some pictures of that, but it was cloud covered. We'd come out the west coast of South America, across where the Ecuador and Chile joined, looking down on the Andes, and then very rapidly into the upper tributaries of the Amazon. And we were fortunate one day that the upper tributaries were totally cloud-free, and we got some very spectacular pictures. I wish I could show them of the tributaries. And there must be a million rivers that are tributaries to the Amazon. Just absolutely fascinating. And so that, to me, was orbit. I cannot, as I try as I hard, I cannot lump those into a distinct entity of some. We went to bed early on the fifth day, as early as we could, knowing that the next day was the last final test that we were going to have to do, and that was to bring the spacecraft safely home. Got up that morning and started stowing the vehicle, and it was amazing how much junk you can pull out of lockers in 5 days with four men. And it all has to go somewhere so you can hold it. We stuffed it in every little nook and cranny. Of course, none of it fit. We went up there with about 20 lockers, and I swear we must have 30 lockers to come home. But we finally found a place for it all. Got ourselves strapped down in the seats, and I closed the big pedal bay doors, and we maneuvered into the attitude for executing our deorbit burn. And somewhere out of the Indian Ocean, we burned those thrusters to start us on the way home. We glided from the Indian Ocean over, made a pass over Australia, and came up on Guam as the last contact pass before entry interface. We were pleased to hear that the ground tracking signal agreed with our solution on board and that we were in good posture for reentry and that things should be normal. We passed Guam and started by Mach 24. The windows started glowing cherry red. First, a very rust color, then a violet color, then pretty soon a bright orange color. That's the glow that stood off of the window. It was in the Mach region. That was fascinating to us because nobody had ever seen that. Nobody had been in darkness that long in the range. The orbital mechanics of when you launch sets what your daylight night cycle is going to be for landing. And nobody had seen as much darkness as we saw. And that glow stayed with us now through Mach 18. One of the more humorous things happened on the flight of Mach 18 is that Vance had to take over manually and do a pushover pull-up maneuver. This was a flight test maneuver. We had about 47 flight test maneuvers on board the spacecraft flight tests that we did. So it really wasn't a ladder, it was just a totally operational flight. There was an awful lot of testing involved. But
Joe was sitting in the middle between the Vance and I, a little bit behind us, there's a flight engineer wing. And Vance starts the pushover. And that old glow starts moving right in towards that window. And I said, Vance, do you really want to do this? And Joe says, Vance, you really don't want to do this, do you? So we said, well, go ahead. And he pushed it on down to a 35 degrees angle of attack. And that glow was just all of a sudden, it looked like it would have been about 4 feet right at my nose. And I decided the one way I could make it go away would be to ignore it. So I looked at my instruments and the rest of the time. But when he pulled it back up to 45 degrees out for that, pulled the nose back up, the glow, because of the geometry based on the shockwave, the glow moved away from the windows, and that was quite comfortable. And when we got up to 45 degrees out for the glow was standing there for a nice discreet distance away from the windows, and I thought, well, that's a good way to do it. And unfortunately, we had to come back down to 40 degrees, and that glow just started moving right back in there. And the best analogy I could think of is just like looking inside of one of these blast furnaces over here at Republic Steel. That's just what that glow looked like sitting all around it. And the cockpit got hotter and hotter, so I felt like I was sitting right there looking at that Republic Steel. The landing was kind of anticlimactic. Vance did a superb job. My big job, as I was quoted on television a number of times, to save my career, I had one little thing to do. I think I had more than that to do. But basically, the most important thing I had to do was at 400 feet when Vance said gear, I had to go punch. I had to get those gear down because it would have been very embarrassing to land the gear up. I guess I saved my career because we got the gear down at 400 feet. Vance greased it on to a perfect landing. That, in a nutshell, is a flight. Some of my personal feelings about it. I personally am very proud to be part of the leadership crew. I again repeat myself, but I think that you should be proud that you had the vision and foresight to support a program that was dreamed up and thought about in 1971 and is finally coming to fruition. And I think very soon it's going to be commonplace. 1984, we're going to have one launch a month. We have a tremendous amount of business pile up. As we do, we're going to make money for the country. We're going to be able to support other space exploration based on this data. So all in all, I think we've developed a tremendously successful system. And I thank you for your support and your guidance. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Colonel Overmyer. Today at the City Club, we're listening to Colonel Robert Overmyer, pilot of the Space Shuttle Columbia. In just a moment, we'll turn to our traditional question and answer period, but first, some short announcements. A reminder first about membership in the City Club. Colonel, if you'll forgive me, in your reference to Earth as a jewel, may I use that phrase to refer to the City Club, because to me that's another jewel. We're a completely non-exclusive organization, open to all public-minded citizens who'd like to know what's going on in their city, in their state, and in the world. Right here is where we deal with the most important issues of our time, as today's forum evidences. We want you to be an official part of what we do. For information about our membership, just phone us at 621-0082 and we'll make it possible for you to join. 621-0082. Today we have our guests, as our guests, students from the Cleveland Public Schools. They're attending as part of the Living Seminar Student Educational Program, which the City Club operates in cooperation with Cleveland Public Schools and Colorado Community College. Today especially, we have students here from the Cleveland School of Science, as well as one student from each of the 14 Cleveland Public High Schools who have been identified as outstanding science students in their respective schools. Will they stand to receive our greeting? They'll be meeting with Colonel Overmyer for their own seminar right after our forum here. Finally, just another reminder, 2 days from today, this Friday, at our regular forum, our speaker will be Dr. James David Barber of Duke University, speaking to us as a spokesman for Amnesty International in honor of Human Rights Day. You can still make your reservations today for this important event. Now for our questions for Colonel Overmyer. We have two microphones, Alan Davis over here, Dr. Conrad over here. Raise your hand to be recognized, and we'll move on to the first question.
Well, there's a lot of questions I'd like to ask Colonel Overmyer, but I
a mass of redundant backup systems, so it's hard to be very specific when I say that. The Apollo, Gemini, and Mercury capsules that land on the water had to land on the water because of the abort situation of the Cape. It required a parachute descent, and as we did on Apollo, two parachutes could give you a safe descent, and we always used three. So there were a number of flights where we had a shroud over the parachute, or one, and the year was 15, and it actually had one parachute virtually totally failed, and it recovered with two. The problem with, of course, water recovery is that in the case of the capsule, it's not a very elegant way to go. If you can't rapidly turn that vehicle around. You're also looking at a return weight vehicle of about, I think the Apollo capsule at its very most is 6,000 pounds. 6,000 pounds for the Apollo capsule that get back to the water. Our return weight for Shuttle 5 was 205,000 pounds. It would take one heck of a lot of parachutes to return this vehicle. There's no practical way you're going to bring 205,000 pounds from Earth orbit unless you had a system like that Earth with a horizontal landing system. If you want to throw it all away like we used to do and throw all those parts away and just come back with the nose cones and all that, you could do that, but then that defeats our whole purpose of the reusability of Columbia. Digging into the Columbia system is just too much to mention, but let me just say a few things. I've got a board. Fly with four computers tied into absolute lockstep. We call that a redundant set. I can lose any two of those computers and still have the other two doing their thing and bringing them. I have a fifth computer as a backup. We call it the backup flight system. It doesn't have quite the exotic guidance in it, but if any time I'm on the way downhill, I have to be out of ground, if my redundant set breaks up on me, I punch a button right on my stick, click, and I just dump those four computers and I'm not flying single screen on a backup simple. Same computer, but simpler software. We have three APMs, auxiliary power units, which is a misnomer because they're the primary source of power to drive the other ones. I can come home on one, not very comfortably. Come home very comfortably on two. Three is nice to have. Again, you just go through the whole system, and there's this total redundancy everywhere you go that gives us this capability for the horizontal landing. And I guess I would only submit from a pure engineering technological standpoint, to bring that amount of mass and weight home from orbit, you need a system that we have to land horizontally with indifference to it. In other words, you're never going to have more than just capsules and other parachutes. You're not going to have large bodies.
And currently, you put a couple of satellites up in space. Other satellite capsules are up there via rockets. Other countries have put them up in space, and also there are some spent satellites, I presume, and other material in space. How many operational satellites are there now in space, approximately? And secondly, what happens to the satellites after they've finished their orbits and can no longer stay up in space? How do they come back to Earth?
I will have to give you a very honest answer on the first one, which I don't know. We have a tremendous amount of satellites in orbit. And I have the foggiest idea. I know right now they're concerned that the geosynchronous orbit, which is 23,000 nautical miles, about 25,000 star foot miles, the geosynchronous orbit is getting slightly filled with them, not from a satellite hitting each other concern, but from a frequency overlap. Geosynchronous, of course, is the altitude at which a satellite orbiting the Earth remains stationary over that portion of the Earth. Of course, it's important to us to have our communication satellites, for the most part, geosynced, because then you can take your Earth station and point it at the geosynced satellite and just, the one on the East Coast, the big satellite, just years can talk to that satellite on the West Coast, and that's how you can make your station. So it's important to us. Again, the total number that geosynchronous is not a concern as far as hitting each other, because if you take the volume of that sphere that these things are in, 23,000 miles of a radius out to it, you realize that the chances of a 15-foot long by 8-foot diameter satellite running into another one become minuscule, if possible. But the frequency, radio frequency overlap is a problem, and that will continue to be a problem. And there are international committees meeting probably this very day concerning those kind of problems. I'm sorry, I can't tell you how much space junk we have up there. I really don't know. We, ago are now under international treaty in a shut-off mode that when they have lived their useful life, they must be able to be shut off. Since shut off, there's an effort maybe to keep a boost capability so when they go to geosync orbit, that they can be boosted out of that orbit just to make room for other satellites. Some satellites in low Earth orbit will just naturally, their orbits will be taken up that they will return on their own, but the high ones will never. So I just inadequate to answer that. I have a question. I apologize.
Colonel, I want to thank you for your presentation. As a former staff sergeant, I never felt my colonels could communicate as well as you could. And I would assume that in the criteria for the selection of astronauts, the ability to communicate must be primary in terms of the work you've just given us. But then I also have a question for Mr. Grace. One of our previous speakers at the City Club raised the subject of the military applicability of the space shuttle. So I wonder if you could speak to that.
That question is clear today. Yes, 25% of the payload capability of shuttle is dedicated to the Department of Defense. I personally don't know anything about those satellites going up at this time. I really, because I do have to go out and talk to the public, I really don't care about personally. But I, as a taxpayer and as a citizen of this country as well as you, recognize that the military has been launching numerous satellites every year, up to 25 launches a year. And I recognize that those satellites are up there for Department of Defense purposes or for purposes of this country. And I haven't had enough faith in my administration and the people who know that they're being used in a proper and fit way. I'm not in a position to even mention what has been conjectured in the papers about what the satellites are used for, but I believe they just leave it on the head when, these satellites are great to me in times of heavy crisis, like the Afghanistan crisis, the Iranian crisis, and they become tremendously in demand. So whatever they're used for, I recognize that the Department of Defense has a requirement, and they can do it two ways. They're going to launch those satellites whether the shuttle exists or not. They're either going to launch on an unmanned vehicle and pay a premium price to do it, or they're going to join the NASA scientific and commercial community together jointly in a launch system, a space transportation system, which is STS, Shuttle 5, Shuttle 6, whatever. They're going to join us and fly jointly and help reduce the cost. We still have one major unit of our vehicle that we throw away. That's the big booster tank that goes up. We have no way capable presently to save that tank. You've got to buy for every launch, you've got to buy a tank. It's a lot cheaper to buy 400 tanks per tank than it is to buy 200 tanks. If we can pull together all the DOD launches, the scientific launches, and the commercial launches, and pull them all together in one lump, and buy more of those items on a standard production run, then the whole cost of access to space is going to come down. And it's one of those, I think it's going to feed upon itself. As the cost of access to space comes down, the capabilities we perceive from space down to Earth will increase. We will then want to access space more. It's going to be a self-feeding kind of thing. And all I can say is I to support the military use of the shuttle, and I quite frankly get quite disturbed when some of our press gets on us so much because NASA is such an open program. Necessarily carry the DOD classified payloads. And I, as a taxpayer and citizen, feel that those are necessary payloads and we shouldn't really say, hey, we need those things. Let's go do it that way. I often say, think that the man on the street who supports our Defense Department possibly agrees with me that we're interested in that.
Are there any plans to have a female minority mission on one of these flights in the near future?
Yes. Sally Rye, a good friend of mine, my flight student, taught her to fly, taught her to sail, is flying as mission specialist on Mission 7, Flight 7. As you may or may not know, the flights are announced about a year ahead of time. And so we have flights through Flight 10, the crews are announced. And then Sally's on Flight 7 with the airport, assuming Flight 6 goes well, that's on Challenger, the new vehicle. And Flight 7 is Sally. We have Flight 8 and Flight 9 flying this back in the next September after refurbishment. So we'll have a two-orbiter fleet starting in January with Flight 6.
to the spacecraft, like in the airlock, you're all in a medical cold water pump suit.
But once you're off the umbilical of the spacecraft and just working on it as a separate, you have a flash evaporator system in this thing called a spacesuit, which essentially boils water to cause a cooling effect. It's all part of the laws of physics, if you will. And this cooling water down is pumped again to these spaghetti of the spin or the underwear to keep it cool. And it works extremely well. So we didn't get a chance to prove that one in space, unfortunately. That was the one detail that we really wanted to do, but we're not allowed to. But we're able to because of that. Carl, can you tell us something about where the Russians are with the launch capacity? What weight can they bring back? As I know, the Soviets to this day have not demonstrated any other capability of getting manned spacecraft back to Earth except under the parachute system. There are Soviet spacecraft, which I'm intimately familiar with, weighs about 2,000 pounds with the crew member headed on landing, which is one reason why they can make a land landing. Everybody has made a big fuss about them landing on land, and all they do is make a lighter weight capsule. Plant it down on land under keeping the size protein. I am reluctant to downplay their capability. I doubt if they have much capability to return to a soft land landing, much more than about 6,000 pounds, I think we'll probably get up to 100. That's my guess. And we would think their capability in that area, they have not demonstrated to us. That doesn't mean they're not working like feverishly at all. But they, at this point in time, have not demonstrated any capability on that line, similar to what we have to show. So it takes a weak re-entry vehicle developing a lift to bring, like an airplane, to bring the massive weights down that we're talking about, the 200,000 pounds weight. And they have not demonstrated that capability to the Western world yet. Doesn't mean it won't happen tomorrow. I'm going to wake up tomorrow and realize the papers say that it happened, but at this point in time, they're not demonstrating that capability.
What are the possibilities? Space shuttle on several trips to build permanent structures where people would stay and do whatever they would do over long periods of time.
I hope you stay. I firmly believe that the United States should endeavor to put a permanent manned presence in space. I think there's a tremendous amount of good you can do in space, and we don't, as we sit here, know what that good is for. We know a lot of it. And like everybody else, I believe if we get there, we'll demonstrate more and more than United can do. There is an ongoing design program with many of our contractors, many of our centers, Lewis is actively involved in this, in which we're looking at modular concepts of putting modules in the payload bay. The payload bay, you can think of payload 60 feet long and 15 feet back, of taking modular payloads of that size, up to 65,000 pounds. And hooking together in space with multiple space launches in which you would have your living accommodations, your docking facilities to it, and all the things you need to do in space permanent, including experiments, including the various things you need to do in space. That's actively being pursued. I hope we get a commitment to go ahead and work on that so that by the late 1990s we are actively pursuing that goal with a date that somewhere in that time frame, the late 1980s. To actually have this space station continue. And the beauty of it is, if you fill it high enough, it'll never be out. If you tank it, so if it takes once to melt, you can adjust it to it. Then you can have, you just keep adding and adding and adding, and you really have space city.
Based on your interesting background, so with the military background, then working together with the Soviets on this Soviets program, and then going up in the space shuttle, could you give me a few of your own thoughts as to where you see the future of space? In particular, do you see it, or what are your feelings concerning the use of space for military other than communications? In other words, putting missiles or offensive type weapons up there after your experience seeing the Earth as a tool?
Well,
yeah,
2 minutes, and I would really like to duck that question on the use of the military because, one, I have been too close to it in the past, and two, we're talking about some very, very sensitive areas that our Congress, the watch those in Washington and looking at them, and it's really up to them to pursue. And it would be really outlined for me to make much discussion. I think space is for man to observe things like hurricane development, is to observe on the Earth's surface. All kinds of things. I told you with my naked eye, I could make out the runway for Hawaii. I think there's a tremendous potential there from a pure land stamp, exploitation of the geology and this kind of stuff. There's just tremendous avenues for these. And I could stand here and talk for hours about some experiments called CFIS that are aboard SDS-4 and SDS-6, which are taking developing medicines in space. We get crystal growth, we get potential developing new kinds of steels and tools in space. Just a tremendous area that I don't have the time to talk to you right now, quite frankly. I'd love to talk to you because it's so important and so important to me personally.
Your next flight into space?
Well, obviously, I don't know. I'm going to go back to work in Houston after a few more. We go to Congress and testify before Congress Space Subcommittee on Wednesday. We'll probably have another couple months of on the way of talking like this. And then it's back to work in the astronaut office, and I become one of those who want to do the outer hope. There's 12 flights in 1984, and it's Apollo, I mean, it's Shuttle 11 through 22 or 23. And I hope one of them has Apollo